Okay, danke Marco. I'll instantly switch to English and thank you for the flattering introduction. Yes, it's my pleasure to introduce over the next 80 minutes, I guess, the Project Genesis, which was realized at the end of April 2020. And before we dive into it, I want to play you a short introductory video clip to set the mood for what we are about to talk about.
Do you have a name? Do you have a VR set on your head? Can you take it off? Can you change VR sets with other avatars? Do you have an opinion?
So what you've seen were a few video clips out of the piece Genesis. And before we'll go into detail into explaining what the piece specifically is, I would like to give a very brief overview of the work. So Genesis is a is kind of a real life computer game in which for 1 week, four human avatars are in a factory hall and are connected via wireless video and audio headsets to a browser interface. And this browser interface can be accessed by players around the world for for these 7 days. And the players over the browser would see what those four human avatars would see and could play with them as in a computer game, giving instructions over a microphone. So in this section, you hear the instructions of the players over the internet who tell the avatars what to do.
Can you make a earth with your hands? No, make him a hug with your arms. Fine. Is
Then show him a heart.
it good?
Yes, nice.
Is it still good?
That's the tone which I hear. Does it come from this instrument?
Nimm ruhig eine Abkürzung, wenn du sie kennst.
Ah, okay. Okay, you might follow her, yeah. Let's see. What is her plan?
So it's a online mediated real-life computer game, and it has certain aspects of a game-like approach, but it's also supposed to be like a social experiment, so to say, investigating aspects of virtuality and interaction through mediated communication channels over technology. So it's a setting that deals with the question of how communication, of hierarchy, of how control is shaped through a technology-mediated communication. And it, of course, also has to do with aspects of embodiment and empathy. And it is also a question of kind of a community world building. So as there were basically no rules for this whole game and it started with a blank hall, it's also a question of how people, or specifically the players of this game, shape a world, imagine a world, and what rules they construct, and what social norms they play by during those 7 days. So it's a game structure, but the goal is to kind of observe how people communicate and interact through technology-mediated communication. In this presentation, I would like to, together with Carola Schaal and Heinrich Horwitz, who are here today, to also give their input on this project. We'd like to go through 8 different points, and that is the development process of the piece, a technical overview of how it has been realized, a brief evaluation of what kind of players took part. The main part will be about interactions, analyzing of what kind of communications happened between the avatars and the players. Then we'll get some feedback from the performers that in this case would also be Carola Schaal, who participated as a performer slash avatar in that piece. Then we go through some observations of what we realized in the piece and look at some of the scientific results, and then give an overview over the team of everybody who was involved in the piece. At this point, I can also say, if you have any questions, feel free to always ask or interrupt if anything is unclear. I'm very happy to answer questions either during the presentation or at the end, whatever feels better for you. All right, so the first thing is the development process. So giving a brief idea how we prepared this piece. And there were basically 3 points that are relevant for this. First one is reference pieces. Then how we rehearsed leading up to the actual performance, and the material selection that we'd be using. So previous pieces, those are pieces that I've done over the last 2 or 3 years. And the main one probably is Control, that led up to this piece. Control was using a similar technology, so to say, where people in a setting would be controlled by other people who would also again see through a wireless video and audio setup, and basically would see what other people were experiencing and doing. That piece was happening in Oslo back then, and happened in one building. So people being controlled, people controlling, all were in the same location. So it was locally and not online mediated. That was one difference. And the other difference was that piece was kind of, well, to a certain degree staged. So there were actually performers who were doing things that we have been rehearsing. So there were basically different rooms with, forms of performances, or let's say rather offers of interaction. So it was a constructed setting that would evoke situations that would ask for certain forms of social interaction. On the contrary, for this piece, we decided that we did not want to have any script, any narrative, or any rules and goals whatsoever. So you can imagine that that for those 7 days, the piece started in a completely empty hall. And over the 7 days, it was supposed to kind of change and evolve over time. And we were then faced with the difficulty of rehearsing something like this, because the whole piece is basically only shaped through the interactions of the players who would log in. So there was a real it wasn't easy to determine how it would actually go. But the things that we could determine were aspects of how abstract we would how abstract the form of communication or the role of the human avatars would be. So if you imagine people would log in through a browser and would get a 1 hour slot for during which they could see through the eyes of one of the four avatars within the hall and would hear what they would hear, and they could give vocal instructions through a microphone to that player, and that person would do whatever the player would say. So one big challenge or question in while working on the concept for the piece is, how much does the avatar or that human performer know? So and how does that person communicate? And the core question was whether the avatar would be able to speak as well or to communicate back. And we decided against that in order to create an experience that is fairly abstract and virtual, so kind of taking as much as we can the human out of the equation, which of course is not completely possible, and of course also not completely wished for, because then we could also just do a complete computer game. So of course the interesting point is kind of the friction of how we look at that human avatar within that piece, like whether we just still see it as a human being or whether we see it as an abstract entity which we kind of neglect the needs and the wishes and the input of that person. So it was the challenge was just to create something that would reflect this friction. And so to sum up, we couldn't rehearse any specific scenes or so, but what we could rehearse were kind of what rules or where kind of the boundaries would be, and that is something we'll talk a bit more about later as well, but kind of what form of communication we'd be hoping for. And so that was the one part. And the second part was, like I said, the piece ran for 7 days within a completely empty hall. So there was no light, no sound, no furniture, no nothing within that piece when it started. But we created, so the piece was running in one big hall, and next to it was another hall in which we collected materials that could be used within those 7 days. And I'll talk a bit, or we'll talk a bit about that more, but in the development of the piece, that aspect also was quite quite relevant, because we had to choose what sort of material would we be offering. So we've maybe you all know the computer games Minecraft and The Sims, and those were kind of the poles that we've been sort of navigating between. For example, Minecraft, where you just have the kind of simplest form of geometric objects that you can work with, as opposed to The Sims, where you have social objects that determine things that you can do in everyday life. So we wanted to find something where we don't well, where we don't impose so much what is supposed to happen. So that would speak for Minecraft, kind of underlining the idea that you build a world out of nothing, or basically just out of the most simple elements that are available. But we also wanted to have a situation that would evoke certain social interactions and also make it possible that forms of empathy of everyday life and of, well, social situations could arise. So we were in the process kind of trying to find a balance between the two, between those two poles, and this is eventually what we ended up doing. So we had in the end kind of construction material like wood and metal and things like this, but we also had clothes, but also everyday objects like things that you need in a kitchen, that you need in a bedroom, and so on and so forth. So I show a few things. This is the shot of the inventory that was storing all the material that could be used within the piece. Here are a few other shots, and this gives an overview of the majority of the objects that were available. I think we had 2,500 different kinds of objects, and some of them were there in multiples. So this is kind of that is how we determined the the parameters for the piece, and that is basically all we could do. We could not shape, and we also did not want to shape how the piece would go, because that is what the piece is about, trying to find out what happens within that week. But we were kind of trying to turn the parameters in a way to, let's say, to make it realistic that certain things that we would hope for or that we would like to display could actually also happen.
I think I could add one thought, because that's something which I think is interesting in this piece, or which I would say is also unusual for an artistic research, is that we were constantly dealing with this idea of how we could make the most freedom or the biggest freedom for the audience or for the players. And this is something so weird, because we came constantly to borders where we can't, where we anyhow shape. So it's this like total freedom doesn't exist. And that was interesting, I think, because already in the smallest steps, we always cross borders of freedom. And that's, I think, pretty unusual for an artistic research.
Yeah, it's true. Also, to paraphrase a little, we were trying to take ourselves out of the equation as good as possible, which is not possible. So even if you say, I'm not going to take those objects, that is already a decision. Or you say, they are not talking back. So in the end, it is impossible to take yourself out. But like you said, we tried to do it at least to a significant amount. All right, so I'd like to briefly talk about the technical overview. So like I already mentioned, the avatars had a camera and a microphone and headphones attached to their bodies. So here we see Carola in full gear. And what the four avatars would hear and see would be mediated or would be sent directly to the player interface of the players in their browser. We'll see an example of that in a second. So that is the core thing. So about the hall or where the thing took place, I already briefly said that. So on the right side here, you see the performance hall. This is where everything happened, starting from zero at the beginning. And then on the left, there was the item storage room. So that is what you've already seen, where all the material was stored. And in the middle was the hatch That is this thing that you see on the lower right photo. That was kind of the junction where if a player would order a certain object, it would be placed within there, and through this motorized door, the avatar would then have access to that. This is a brief overview of how the storage was organized. And so in correspondence to the headsets that we've seen, which is kind of the core technology, the other core part of the piece is the website that we programmed for that from scratch. And it had a few different possibilities. Well, the one was the live stream where you could for the 7 days observe everything that was happening, but the main part was the playing. And if you would log in through with a ticket, you would be seeing the world through this interface. And in that interface, you see a few different things. On the right, you see the status of your avatar, so giving information whether your avatar is hungry or thirsty or too warm or too cold. On the left, on the left bottom, you see the inventory, which if you click on it, gives you access to the 2,500 different objects, and you could then select those. And if you did that, then those would be made accessible in the hatch that we've just seen before. So I'll show you one or two little clips of how the gameplay would look. This is the last thing. So on the right bottom, there was also a chat with all involved participants within the piece, both spectators and actual players. So you could also communicate with the other involved people who were on the page at that point. So for example, here you see an avatar taking on a piece of cloth, as you can see, because the temperature is too cold on the right top. So that's an example of one action that happened. Here you can see, I assume that is Carola, I guess, an avatar playing with a mixing desk. We'll see more more interesting parts as we go along. Here's an example of somebody selecting an item from the inventory. And if I pause here for a moment, you can see that if you do that, then you get a message that this item will be placed in the hatch. And after a certain amount of time, you'll get another message saying that your item is ready to be picked up. All right, so I've already been talking a bit about the hatch, about this junction between the item storage and the performance hall, but it's also a bit more than that. It's also the kind of the junction through which the human avatars would enter the hall, and it's really kind of like the intersection between the analog outside world and the virtual artificial world in the performance hall, which was kind of dislocated from its surrounding. So in a way, this intersection plays a vital role. This is still in the construction process that we see here now, but you can see how it's how it has been built. And here, that is at the beginning of the performance that you see. And maybe the last part here are two photos of the actual performance of people, of human avatars getting things out of the hatch. And the last thing that I didn't mention yet that kind of belongs to the technical setup of the piece is an arm interface. And this is the blueprint for it, and this is how it looked in real life. So As you've seen before, or as I already said, is that the avatars would have a display of their status, kind of indicating how their temperature, hunger, thirst, and fatigue is. And that is a thing that the human avatars could set with this arm interface, which they had on their wrist all the time. So this kind of was used to communicate the basic needs of the avatars. And aside from that, it had four buttons that could be used to send messages to the players. So the only form of communication that happened from the avatars to the players was through the status and through those messages. So as you can see, it's really the most fundamental feedback that was, well, that you could think of in a way. And that is more or less already the kind of the technical foundation for the piece. I'll show you one or two photos of the control room. This is where we had all the video routers and audio computers and everything set up, and the receivers for the arm interfaces and so on and so forth. So this is kind of where everything went together, and then from that point on went to the was then sent to the website. So kind of here in that hall, in that room, we kind of collected everything in the hall and then connected it through the website. This is Karl Hoffmann, who's been in charge of the internet and video aspects of the piece. And that's the basic, well, explanation of how the piece works. Is that halfway clear, or are there questions?
I have a quick question. How exactly did the audience interact with the performers? So it all happened through the arm?
So the audience, so if you would log in, you would use your microphone to give vocal instructions to the avatars. So in a way, if you had a ticket and connected, then you would see and hear what the avatar sees and hears, and you could use your voice and say something like, now go forward, now turn to the left, now pick up the guitar, and things like this. Maybe now things will become a bit more clear as we'll see some examples that hopefully illustrate this a bit better. Yes, so last thing before we actually go into the concrete examples is a very quick first description of what players took part, or what different kinds of players there were. One, so in general, it worked like this, that you would buy in advance a ticket for a certain time slot. So you would have a ticket, for example, for Wednesday, 3 o'clock until 4 o'clock. You would then log in a bit before that and would have the possibility to play within that time. So that is how it normally went, and almost all tickets were sold out before the piece started. But there were also people who did not pick up the ticket, or left earlier, or things like this. So we also had the possibility to instantly play if a ticket was free. So if you went on the page and a ticket was or one slot was free, you could just press play and jump into it directly. So those were the so-called quick users, where you could just take available slots. In general, we wanted to make it the threshold to engage as low as possible. So basically, you would need to get a ticket beforehand, but we only did that to make sure that actually all the slots are being used. But we didn't want to enforce any borders, so to say. So the only thing that you needed to do is have a working email address, which could be anything. but you did not need to register your name or anything else. You didn't need to pay anything for it. So there was a conscious decision to allow people to interact with the setting in the knowledge that nobody could actually trace them back. So we wanted to do something that was, for example, different to other works that we've done before, where if it happens in a as part of a contemporary music festival or something like this, you know, if I buy a ticket there and am in this hall, then I'm not gonna misbehave most probably, or there are definitely, or the limitations are definitely much higher. And we wanted to create something that is as anonymous as possible to basically really see what people would want to do, even though they can't be traced back. So if you wanted to buy or to get a ticket, you just need any kind of email address. And if you were there as a so-called quick user, just instantly playing, then you wouldn't need to register at all. So you basically could be from, I don't know, any part of the world, just press play and interact with the setting. And well, those are the most fundamental things. And then we also realized that people would behave differently during the night and day, and people would have different goals or different forms of interactions. But those are things we're going to look at in more detail now. So maybe now to the core parts of the of what happened within those 7 days. So, and that is those are the interactions between the players and the avatars. There are quite a few different sorts of things that happened. I'd like to kind of go through them chapter by, or like example by example, and I'm sure that also Heinrich and Carola will help me in that process if I forget something, or also add their observations. So I'll first play you a very short clip of one interaction scene.
Look at yourself in the mirror to see if you can recognize yourself.
So this is here you can see an avatar looking into a mirror. So this is one of the, I don't know, maybe more fairly stranger examples. But to go through the things like step by step. Now, the first thing I'd briefly would like to talk about is the development of the room structure. So as I already mentioned, it started basically with nothing in the room, and piece by piece and step by step, objects were brought into the room, and by that kind of shaping the structure within that step by step. And so here's an a view from the top. I guess that's at day 2, I would assume, and you can see that in the middle here, step by step, or increasingly things were constructed. And here, for example, is a part that sort of served as a kitchen. So kind of one by one elements to cook and food and things like this and cutlery were moved to that space. So that was one of the first parts that was developed, but then also other parts slowly happened. This was some kind of a Zen garden kind of thing. Here's a place that was more like a bedroom, so to say. Here's something that turned out to be something like a living room. And so here's another view of that. Here we can also see another shots of the scenery from different angles. And what we can see in this image here is kind of when the hall was empty at the beginning, things that happened first is that people would use tape or transparent foil or things like this to kind of wrap things around those pillars and to kind of giving a first separation of regions within the hall. And those were kind of then used as a blueprint to sort of structure the room step by step. So you could really see that first somebody would lie something on the floor, then would put a tape, then somebody would put a cupboard next to it. So it was really like one after the other happening over those 7 days. And we had one person in the team, Luca Befera, who is a musicologist, but also sort of in this setting was working a bit like an ethnographic observer. And he's made quite comprehensive analysis of the development parts. And here's an excerpt of what he's been working on, kind of giving an overview what rooms were happening at what points within the piece. So yeah, you could see it was building and building over those 7 days, kind of making you wonder what would happen after those 7 days. But at some point, we did have to finish. So that is the more like a, kind of physical observation of what happened. I'd like to now give a more artistic insight, maybe, that also perhaps explains the way the interaction works a bit better. So here are two examples that involve music. It may make sense to say again, even though I'm more or less a composer by trade, there was no notes written or no music decided for this piece. So the only musical elements that would happen were things that the players did on their own. But nonetheless, music and sound played quite a constant role within the piece, but maybe different than one would have thought. But maybe we can talk about that in a moment a bit more. First, I'm going to play two examples of musical instructions and interactions. So just to explain, what you are hearing now is one of the players who's logging in over the through the browser and giving instructions to the human avatar.
Wrap the chain around your right legs. I'd like you to perform a experimental improvisation with your voice using the megaphone, the drum using your hands, and also the styrofoam chain assemblage.
Too fast. So here's one example of how a musical passage could look like. And I'd like to play a second example that also involves Carola performing.
Woo!
Yes. So I think it's both your and my favorite musical passage of
the time. Yes.
So yeah, we can look into that.
Is there a, I think I saw a kind of vibrator or something. Or something that can vibrate. Okay, perfect. Can you put that on the guitar? That, yes, maybe between the accordion and the guitar. And put the vibrator stuff on the guitar, please. Thank you. And now play the accordion. Take the accordion, please. The accordion. Okay. Yes.
So I don't know, Carola, if you want to add something to this.
Wow, it's great to dive in again. So I can just feel it immediately how it felt. So this player had a super concrete idea of what we're able to do, and of course I'm a human being, and he my aesthetical view of music, it was just a super match. So I loved it. So it was also super easy for me to follow his instructions in a way. It was a super euphoric moment. But just, because I really like this kind of music he created. So it, that's why it created a super, maybe a super strong output, because I love the input.
That's nice. So in a way, though, like those are two examples also of more like kind of active musical actions. One other thing is also people working on this piano. But so this is one aspect of what happened like sonically within the piece. Another part that was not so much anticipated, which was fairly dominant, is that the material we provided were also an organ, a record player, a guitar, a keyboard and things like this, and a DVD player and a CD player and so on. So what was actually very dominant was things being on loop or kind of constantly on in a way. So for example, there was a record player with a scratch on the vinyl, and it would be running like for really, really long durations, or sometimes accompanied by a demo rhythm of a keyboard that was just kind of running and running. Somebody turned it on and nobody turned it off again. So there were all people taping down keys on a keyboard. And it's, for one, it was maybe sonically interesting, but it also was in a way very fitting for what this place actually was, because maybe I'm jumping ahead a bit already, which is part for the observations later, but it's this, that this place was kind of so dislocated from time and space in a way that it kind of created this microcosm for 7 days where the kind of the outside world was super blended out in a way. It was also, we blacked out the ceiling, so it was more or less a black box, so to say. So it was like kind of lost in time and space, and that sort of underlined this this virtual feeling, or this very artificial aspect of that installation. And these things being on loop kind of in a like a forgotten place, so to say, were underlining this quite heavily, which was not really anticipated, but kind of felt very natural in the way it built a soundtrack to what the place was.
Yes, maybe I could also add something, because to this like timeless feeling of something is going on forever, and as we as a team had the chance to look at it over the whole time, so of course we slept in between, but we really participated in how the whole setup was built up. I would also add that it became this kind of historic and also futuristic space in the same time. So as there was no real day and night time, and people added things more and more and created more and more spaces on top of each other, it became this like past and future at the same time. And it's funny, because looking back and seeing all these clips, it really feels like it's including a narrative, or there are even figures, and even, and this is also something we talked about a lot afterwards, like how that the avatars felt like they became figures in a narrative, even though we didn't do that. And the players only played for 1 hour, but still adding up all these ideas and all these artistic decisions the players did, somehow the space became something else than just like, because this, that was also a fear we had. It didn't become just a pile of trash. It really evolved into something else.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, aside from kind of looking or observing how people would use the control they have over a human being, that also was the other big aspect of kind of observing a kind of collaborative community behavior. So in a way, that's also very typical for processes that you would observe in online communities, like where you have a big amount of users who are not in the same room, who don't know themselves personally, but who work on the same thing. So in a way, even though this piece for the human avatars and in their hall was like really, really physical, it was like very heavy to perform for 7 days, almost nonstop. But what it's kind of the rules or the implications are very closely linked to online community behavior. And exactly also what Heine says is this thing that things are being constructed, then continued by somebody else. So, but also sometimes destroyed. So that is something also we wanted to make possible, that people can build something, support each other, but that they can also take away things again, destroy it or hide things or so it's one of the goals was to display different aspects of community behavior. We'll definitely see a few more of those aspects also as we go along. Maybe I'll show another little clip that involves eating. So in the objects that you can order through the inventory, there was also food. So in general, it was possible for the avatars to exclusively eat within the setting. Maybe also afterwards, Carola can say something regarding that. I'll play a short clip of that. So we see the sort of kitchen in front of us. The music you hear is something that's being played on the record player.
That guy over there. Are you hungry? Okay. Okay, so, yeah, get a plate.
I abbreviated it a bit, but now comes the part where the avatar also, I'm sorry. That was one escape too much. So, the players would could also order food for the avatars, especially if the indicator would show that they are hungry in the status bar. And Carola, if I remember correctly, you kind of mostly ate within the setting, right? From a certain point on.
Yes. So that was really interesting. To observe that I really wanted to become really a part of this setting, and that also included eating, drinking, smoking within the setting. I think I decided that already on the second day, that I also want to have breakfast in the setting. I try to let the player know that I'm hungry and that I'm thirsty. So I want to drink a coffee and I want to eat cini-minis. And that felt absolutely right to then really become one with the performance hall. I liked it.
All right, cool. So maybe I'll jump to the next subchapter, which is sort of related to the room development. So what I mentioned before is that people would create those rooms with specific functionality, like kitchen, bedroom, living room, and things like this. There was a tent and other things, but there one of the possible goals that people pursued was also to create sort of artworks. I'll show a few parts. So this is kind of a very nice installation, I thought, that people constructed within it. Well, this is a thing with a figurine, and I think the parts that you see up here is actually a smashed violin. the player who did that was Pedro Gonzalez, who's I unfortunately don't have the clip, but he made his avatar smash the violin, a thing that he as a trained violin has never done in real life before. So he was kind of really excited to finally get the possibility to do that. And well, he created this this artwork out of it. And one part is then also, well, the artworks themselves, but another thing that's interesting is how or what the players actually would pursue within that setting and how similar or not similar this is to what they would do in their original or in their real life. So every now and then we would observe players who would kind of try to recreate what their abilities in their real life are. For example, there was a trained pianist who would then kind of use his avatar to perform piano music on a keyboard. But this junction of the interface and also a bit the lack of the knowledge of the human avatar executing this motion was like really, well, there were definitely a lot of frontiers in between that made that process more difficult. So for us, it kind of also raised the question, why do people want to recreate, if they're given the possibility to do whatever they want, why do they want to recreate what they already can do in their normal life, but better or easier? So there was a kind of interesting, because it's raised the question, and that was a bit also what the piece is about, to create a space that is also a space of possibilities. So a space where you can do what you want to do and where you can also shape the world the way you want to, and you can, well, you're given the freedom to do whatever you want. And that, I think, was also perceived in different ways by the players, because we did not give any rule or aim or anything like this to the players. So it felt overwhelming and intimidating to some of them, or some of them simply felt lost because they didn't know what to do with it. Whereas others knew very specifically what to do. And that is definitely one differentiation between players that we had, some who came with a very clear vision, idea, goal, or objective, and some didn't. And that is something that both in the conception of the piece and while it ran and also afterwards, we had a lot of discussions about whether that is a good thing or not, whether this also this boredom or this this that people were overwhelmed by the possibilities and then maybe also ended up doing boring stuff or stuff that you wouldn't want to look at. So that's some of the things then in the live stream that people did were just boring, but the question is that good or bad? And that is, I think, one of the key things that we did not want to create a participatory staged theater piece, which you could look at from the outside. Because if you wanted to do that, then we do a staged theater piece. The idea is rather to throw people into a situation where they have to make up their minds themselves. So, and if that is boring or caring or creative or misusing, then that's what it is. And so I personally kind of also liked those boring parts or this emptiness of it. A bit like when you are in a computer game and you're in some space and you don't really know what to do, and you kind of just hang around, see a few things lying on the floor, and you're just trying to figure out what to do with the situation. And in a way, I don't know, you got to figure out the same thing in your life anyway. So maybe it also enforces a few things. So in any case, it was, there was something that was happening for sure.
May I ask something really quickly?
Please.
You were now talking about boredom. I would be curious whether you also experienced the opposite, whether there were moments where people went too far with their demands. Because what you just described also reminds me a little bit of a performance by Marina Abramović, which happened in the 70s. I don't remember the title, but it was also a setup where she offered various items that could be used, and she just said to the audience they can basically do with her and the items whatever they want. And this turned out to be, Marina Abramović was really often going to extremes, but according to her own reports, this was a sort of traumatizing experience because people really got violent to a degree where she was frightened for her life. So this was, of course, a very different context and a different time, etc. So I would be curious whether there were also moments where you felt uncomfortable, where people asked things from you to do that just felt inappropriate.
Yeah. So
it's called rhythm zero.
Exactly. So yeah, of course, that is one of the references for that we had in mind for that piece. But yes, so we've kind of been observing both caring and controlling, or to a certain degree, abusive instructions. And I've got a few examples prepared for this, but I don't know, maybe Carola, would you like to, you as a as you were there firsthand, just tell us a bit about it?
Marco, I have it in mind. I would give a comment on it later, okay?
Sure, thanks.
Okay.
What is maybe to say, to answer now, is that the range was really, really different. So it was a lot of caring parts, as Alex said, but also, people were building stuff for their home. People were destroying a lot. So there was also a lot of destroying, like the stuff, not the performers, not the avatars. It was a lot of there was some massaging and yoga session. So the range was really, really big.
Yeah. Maybe we can take a look at a few of those very briefly. So you've seen a bit the spectrum, and then I'm sure we can also answer your question, Marco, in more detail then. So here are a few things of where caring situations occurred. I'll play a little clip. Thank you.
take away the heart.
All right. Yeah, so those were a few kind of like outside perspective of things where people were kind of interacting with each other in a kind of social caring way. And here's, I would like to show a brief example also what Heinrich already just mentioned of where players were kind of doing self-care with their avatar. So here's an example where they where the player asked the avatar to massage the legs and the arms.
Das andere auch. Kannst du deine Beine festhalten?
So yeah, that's an example. That is a not uncommon example of how people would take care of their avatar.
It was also often that they had an aim and that they did follow this aim, but then they build in breaks for the avatar. So they said, now you have a break, now you take the bike and take a round with the bike as a break. Or you need a drink, let's get a drink and then get back to work. So they really, like I would say a lot of them understood this work-life balance in the game.
Yeah, absolutely. Often also, yeah, some people who had a very clear game then in the end said, okay, now we've been working so much, now the last 5 minutes are just for you to relax and to lie in the tent or so. I'd like to play to you two examples of different forms of, let's say, how people dealt with control in the piece. One more positive, one side the less positive example. Yeah, so I'll play two of them. The first one is just audio.
I am, for telling you, I am a little disturbing because I give you order and I don't like that, but I think it's fun between us and we have a good relation. Okay, great. So let's cook for some.
So those kinds of introductions or like how people were kind of contextualizing their role to the avatar was fairly common. So this kind of in different variations occurred several times. Here's another example.
Okay, go to the wall and put your body against the wall. And put your shoulder, your upper body against the wall.
Oh yeah, this kind of turns into a fairly long sequence of not very comfortable interactions with the wall. So you kind of see this gives a first example of less caring instructions. And I'm sure we'll come back to that in a moment again. Like related to that also violence and destruction, I'd like to play a few examples of interactions that were less constructive. So, I mean, kind of that deals on the one hand also with the social interaction, but also with the this kind of communal relation of the space that's being constructed. So it's not only about the communication between player and avatar, but it's also about how you treat the kind of spaces that other people created before you.
Smash the piano.
Was hebeln?
Yeah.
So those were also aspects that that happened within the piece. Maybe then now we can go one step further. So at how, let's say, more observing the player side of things, and now sort of switching more to the performer experience. So the how the human avatars within the setting experienced everything, and maybe that's the moment for Carola, for you to continue what you were already starting to talk about.
Yes, Marco, I also keep your question in mind. A few things. So maybe the first thing I want to mention is the really special way to getting prepared for this 24/7 performance. So the most interesting thing was in advance to really position boundaries. So own boundaries, try to imagine the 7 days performance. And yeah, what we did together with Heinrich to really build up a setting or a really good mood of full trust between the four performers, because we were not able to talk to each other in the setting. So we tried to find a good way of feeling, yeah, to really trust each other and to understand body languages and things. And yeah, that really worked. So Heinrich did a wonderful job to prepare us for this challenge, this task. And then, so one thing from my personal perspective is that I kind of underestimated the intimacy to walk around and to sleep and to rest and to act with these glasses and to have a constant voice talking, giving orders, sometimes dominant, sometimes most of the time carrying, and really lovely things, but also, yeah, really strong things. And I underestimated it. I was also super sensitive, and yeah, because you could not talk back. But maybe two really lovely, or one really lovely thing, a player from abroad, he was a quick user, and I felt that he just wanted to talk about the pandemic situation. He didn't know to whom he can just point out all the anxieties he's facing at the moment. And I tried to give him space to just let him talk, and it was super touching. And of course he said, but you can't answer, but I, yeah. And so he just, yeah, he told me all his anxieties about the situation, about the lockdown, about what's going on with the world. But that created a super intimate situation. And I didn't want him to leave. I wanted him to go on talking for hours, but of course he just had 55 minutes or around 50. So that was one really touching moment I still think about. I hope this player is fine and he's able to deal with it. And the other situation was, I was really, as a human being, I was really hungry. So I put the hunger on the highest level, and my player reacted like Oh, you know what? I give a fucking shit on your hunger. Okay, that was super interesting for me, because to not react as a human being and being pissed is almost not possible. So that was a strong moment for me, of these moments, of these constant ping pong moment of, okay, being yourself, so this self-determination and this kind of external control, and try to realize what the player wants me to do. And yeah, I was pissed because I was hungry. Yeah, and I also really like this moment of that professional piano player gave me instructions of...
What, you?
Again?
Was it you who was... I didn't know it was you who was playing the piano.
No, that was a different moment. He ordered me gin, so I had a bottle, and he asked me to open the piano, and he was also sitting at home at his piano. So he was playing the keys, and he asked me with a gin bottle to improvise on the keys and on the strings, and also to smash the bottle on the piano. And that was a really nice piece we created together. I loved it. And because he asked me, are you able to play piano? And I said, yes. And he said, okay, show me. And I was just sitting with my ass on the keys. And so he understood that I'm not really able to play. But we found a moment to really create music together, and I loved it. It was great.
Yes.
Yeah. And so, Marco, to your in the rehearsal moments, we also talked about we build up a safe word if there is a moment which is too much and you can't stand it anymore, that you're able to kick somebody out. I thought, oh, maybe that's too much. People know how to behave, and that there are really borders which you should not overstep. But actually, I was the one who used the safe word, because there was one guy who really stepped over borders of myself, and I couldn't stand it anymore. I didn't know what to do. I was also, because then I used my voice to say the safe word, and I was really scared that I might not be able to use my voice anymore. And I used it, and I kicked this player out. It felt really abusive. That was super, super strong. So I was kind of happy and thankful that we that we created this moment of safe space using or having a safe word.
I mean, yeah. So in a way, I think it happened a few times, especially during the night shifts. I think that this kind of more abusive connotation in the instructions occurred. I think one thing that can be said is that there were a few like very specific things that would cross borders, like of a sexual nature or cutting through a power cord that was plugged in or things like this. So some things were like very explicitly harmful, but what one I think should not underestimate is also the more subversive, abusive character that some people had in their instructions, in a setting where also, as you, Kaola, mentioned, when the avatars were exposed to a sort of vulnerable situation of commands and control constantly, also to a certain degree sleep deprived, it's then sometimes more this kind of subversive in the kind of the way you use your voice and the way you like the tone of it, or that actually can also result in an impact like this. So it's, I would say it has not only been like very specific things, even those things also happened, but it's also been, yeah, the kind of the subtext of the communication. Aside from the aside from the avatar evaluation, so to say, how it felt for the performers, and aside from analyzing how the players interacted, I'd also like to share a few observations that we kind of looked at in general or were recognizing during the piece. And so a few aspects that emerged during this time was, for example, despite the social communication between player and avatar, the fact that you're always being watched in a way is also special and noteworthy. For example, I was at some point filling in for an avatar and doing one shift, and during that session I was preparing potatoes and eating potatoes with sour cream and things like this, and the player was not really giving me a lot of instructions or feedback. So basically the person was simply sort of watching through my eyes and perceiving what I was perceiving. And this mode of that somebody is always with you in a way, kind of even has a kind of godlike quality to it, can be in a way maybe intimidating, but it also has this this aspect of that it gives whatever you are doing some kind of additional worth, so to say. And I was kind of wondering if you would be within this sort of setting constantly, how strange it would feel if you would take that away again, so that you can kind of get used to it. And like I said before, that this kind of very physical setting is also strongly a metaphor for things happening in the online community. So in a way that also depicts in a way how you get used to sharing what you do through social media channels, for example. So this always on, always present, always sharing, always linked to, through technology to something else, and can also be found within that perception. And it's also deals with this question, if you disconnect this link, whether the thing that's happening in the physical space loses its meaning through that. One other very prominent part was the already mentioned kind of void. So this kind of dislocation of time and space. So the space that we created there, or that was created there, was so taking away from everything that was surrounding it in a way. There was no clear form of time anymore. And as it's just been those four players and the interaction through that room was solely through the internet, it had a very kind of it felt like really dislocated from the surrounding world. It in a way really created a space that would feel like a space within a computer game or within a 3D rendered setting. Of course it was real, but the quality that it was evoking was very much like this. And that had to do with the fact that the only interaction came from the outside. It also had to do with the fact that actually the communication from the players was sometimes very lively in a way. They were talking, they were caring, they were giving instructions and things like this. But in that hall, you wouldn't hear that. So that hall also had a very empty feeling to it. It was kind of deprived of important characteristics that were actually shaping that space. So the actual physical space was lacking some important information that was crucial to the functionality of it. So that was another point, that it was kind of underlying this this emptiness or this hollowness of this of the setting. But it's also the way that people would use objects or how objects would be placed within that setting. So for example, somebody would use a hammer and just lay it somewhere on the floor, and then somewhere else, I don't know, a dish would lie and a guitar next to it. So of course in an untidy room this sort of thing can also happen, but it's the way you look at it is felt different to how a normal or analog or physical room in the actual world feels like. It is more the perception you had within that room is more an empty space in which object X, Y, and Z are positioned on location A, B, and C. And you kind of look at it and see, okay, it's those are the coordinates. This is the kind of 3D world in which they're located. And now I can think, okay, apply object X to Y, and then use Z, for example. So the logic of those objects and the affordance of it, so the kind of the character of what action they offer the player, feels fundamentally different from the everyday normal life. It follows the logics, or it shows the logic of a kind of a virtual computer game or of an artificial setting. So those rules, or this way to look at the world, or also the way to interact with the world, was very strongly perceivable within that setting. One interesting aspect also, as far as observations of that that setting go, were also the modes of embodiment. So we've already been talking about different forms of hierarchy or caring or different goals. So those kind of display also the intent, or maybe also the social parameters of the players and of the avatars as well. But in a more general way, you could also observe different forms of embodiment. So you could sometimes, the player would use the avatar kind of as himself, so to say. For example, if a person would create an artwork that is more or less the same as an artwork that person would create in real life as well. So it's a form of embodiment where the player takes the avatar really just as their body to execute specifically what they want to do. But in contrast, you would also have the other thing where the player would take the avatar and use it as a body, but to kind of care for it. So not to execute their own wishes or their own needs, but rather to take care of that being. And then there's always also a kind of mixture in between, and it that is also referenced in the way how the players perceived the avatars. So in the research questionnaires that we put out after the installation ended, the players were asked to describe to what degree they perceive the avatar as a human being, as a virtual being, as somewhere in between. And this also shows the kind of the spectrum of how people related to the avatar. Some use them really as a tool for themselves to execute their wishes, some rather took care of it as an entity, or also used controlling instructions to play with that. One other thing that is also was also occurring every now and then is the questioning of the boundaries of the set of the setting. So we've been talking about the boundaries of what the players would ask from the avatars. So there would could be or would be instructions that Fel would overstep the borders of the avatars. So that is those are the borders within or like the personal borders of the performers. But another thing where people were kind of negotiating the borders of that setting was the rules or restrictions of the actual game setting. So saying things like, would you like to take off your headset? Could you go through the door and leave the setting? Could you in some way kind of sabotage the setting that you're in? So it's also been a kind of a question that people were every now and then approaching, like how to break the system. And of course here also we as the creators of the whole setting are confronted also with the borders of the integrity of the setting that we construct, because we try to do it as open and non-restrictive as possible. But in the end, of course, there are also rules how we limit kind of the interaction with the setting to a certain degree. One other aspect that was also relevant for the development of the piece and also for the role of the performers within the setting is the kind of the question of identity of the avatars, or more specifically also of the performers playing the avatars. So the part that we mentioned already is a bit like, how much knowledge do they have and can they talk back? So are they to a certain degree human, or are they just an executing machine, so to say? So that for example also deals with the question, if I tell the avatar construct a small house, does the avatar know what that means? Or do I have to say, pick up the hammer with the right hand, take a piece of wood in the left hand, now put the nail on the top of the piece of wood, and things like this. So that already kind of to a certain degree determined what role or identity or character the avatars had. And we sort of decided for a mode that was fairly close to the mechanic execution, but not too strong, in order not to kind of inhibit a meaningful interaction with the setting through the avatar. But so that was a kind of a thing that also the players would question or would challenge, like the question of identity of the avatar. So people would ask the avatar to write down the name, to ask them about what they want, what they would hope for in that setting, if they could break the setting. So the players wanted to know something about the humans they were interacting with on numerous occasions. So but for that we decided that the avatars would not give any personal information. So they would not give their name, or they would also not answer questions whether they would like to do something. So they could say what their basic needs are through the status, but they were not supposed to say, now I want to play tennis, or now I want to read a book. It's we deliberately created a setting where the avatar is supposed to, for one, execute what the player is saying, And through that also becomes the projection space, or also the kind of the embodiment of the player. And that is a big contrast to the previous work, Control, where the people were talking and it was about the conscious decision whether to control another human being or not, because that person could also speak back. And there was this friction between human and human. But now it's more about the friction between a human and an embodied avatar, where the human player then can determine for her or himself how to fill this and what to project on that person. So that was it was a goal to kind of take the human and identity aspects out of the avatars as good as possible.
We don't have so much time left, so I was wondering if there are some other questions from the other course participants, maybe?
Yes, actually, I was curious how did the sleeping cycles work? I mean, when did you even sleep? Because you mentioned you were sleep deprived, and so what happened? I mean, were the players telling you to go to sleep now, or how did this work?
We had breaks for them. So it was like, they also slept inside the installation, especially in the night shift. Fabian Uhl always did the night shift from, I think he was alone from 4 to 7. And there sometimes also players brought him to sleep. So there was also this moment of letting him lay down and people were talking to his ear. And he also described it, sometimes it was really calm for him that someone else is there and he's not alone. But we also did the Alex did this like really crazy plan of mathematic plan of who has a break when. Of course they had breaks where they could go out and sleep and also take showers.
Okay, thanks.
Yep.
I have another question. Thank you very much for your presentation. I think it's a really nice project. For me, like as you mentioned in the beginning, the material is something between Minecraft and Simpson, what is really broad, I guess. But still like pretty important, because you create somehow like a frame of what can happen. And as I saw on the pictures, many did also like installations or like worked really with the material or smashed stuff. And so you also have this kind of leftover in the end, what was created out of all the material. So maybe you can say a few words about that. Also how you deal as like a artistic piece, what is in the end created. So
some people did ask this specific question, whether then there's some sort of an end product, but nobody was seeing anything that happened in that hall afterwards. So basically everything was disassembled, and we kind of managed to give away like, I think 2/3 of the material afterwards. So we only threw away what was really broken and unusable, but like all the building materials and stuff like this, we gave to artist collectives and stuff like this. So fortunately that worked quite well. But we did not take, I mean, some of us took souvenirs. I've got 2 crowbars, for example, in the cupboard behind me, but we did not nothing left left that scene. So the idea was that nobody should see or touch anything that happened within that hall.
I was also wondering, usually you document your works very carefully, and it struck me that there is hardly practically no documentation at all about Genesis, which made this presentation even more interesting today. So I was wondering, is this a deliberate choice?
No,
let
me tell you a bit about this. Actually, the complete opposite is true. It's in a way we see this piece of work not so much just as the performance or the installation or the game that happened over the 7 days, but it's for me, it's really more like that is kind of the execution, but the artwork itself is actually also the documentation and the making accessible what happened during that time. So we are, due to the sheer amount of the material, we are simply a bit late, because you can imagine we did 7 days of continued video recording with 6 cameras in parallel. So the amount of footage that we had, if you watched it continuously, is over 2 months. So it's just, we've got actually a lot of material, and we are actually very close to releasing all of it. So it's, we do have, we have all the video recordings, audio recordings, we have interviews with the participants, we have a kind of 100-page book by the Ethnographic Observer. We make questionnaires for the players, where roughly 150 people participated. So we've got kind of a examining how they felt within the setting and what the goals were, what their how they perceived the setting, how they would judge the relation with the avatar. So it actually is very strongly about those aspects. And we'll do a documentation that will be released probably in a few weeks. There's going to be a book, and there's going to, and we'll also make most of the tools that we developed available in an open access format. So it's very much about this. And I know that we are a bit late. I'd like to, or let me paraphrase, I would have shown you a clip where one of the players actually is saying, and I'm kind of summarizing this now, he's telling the avatar, look, please be aware of the fact that you have not been the actors or the performers in that piece, but that this piece is about us, that we are being observed. The players are the ones that are on display within that work. So he kind of summarized this, that was on day 7 towards the end, and he kind of drew a summary on its own. And this is actually what the piece is about. It's about observing how people interact and communicate, and what kind of a world they build and want to construct. And there, I'm thankful for your question, Marco, because it is precisely making the results and the observations accessible in the end now. That is a core part of the piece. And maybe, I know we're jumping, we have skipped a few things, but we also don't want to steal too much of your time. So I can at least already jump to the last fall already. Maybe also at that moment mentioning that this piece, I mean, we are here now with Carola and Heinrich, but obviously a piece like this can only be done in a collaborative way that involved, besides us, also Jakob Zello for the arm interface and the ethnographic protocol and the website development. And here also, just so that you can see them again, the 4 avatars who undertook this huge challenge of engaging with the setting. And then we also had people who were collecting all the materials, who were handling the inventory, and who were participating in the rehearsals. So just to give you an overview of how many people were involved in making something like this happen, and also to give a shout out and thank you to the involved participants at that moment too. And maybe that's very roughly trying to squeeze into 90 minutes of what happened within those 7 days, but maybe you also got some additional questions. But in any case, already thank you for your interest, and also thank you, Carola and Heinrich, for being there to share your thoughts.